This video is sponsored by Squarespace. I took my first photo of deep space exactly 10 years ago today. It was a picture of Orion Nebula, and I still remember seeing this picture appear on my DSLR screen and just being so excited by what I saw. In the last 10 years, astrophotography has completely changed my life, and I thought this milestone of 10 years in the hobby was a good time to reflect about what I've learned and pass on some of my advice. My name is Nico Carver, and this is Nebula Photos. There are, of course, a lot of resources to help you learn astrophotography. When I was getting started, I read a lot of books, and I also had in-person mentors at my local astronomy club that were super helpful. Now, of course, I'm an astrophotography educator myself, and I make my living through YouTube and my Patreon community, which is all about helping people learn astrophotography. And I do all this because I think it can be legitimately helpful. But at the end of the day, if you really want to be an astrophotographer, nothing beats practical experience. Just getting out there under the night sky and trying and failing and trying again. Because when you make a mistake and then figure out on your own how to correct that mistake, I think that's when things will really click for you. I could list off a bunch of beginner mistakes so you could try to avoid them, but sometimes you just have to go make the mistakes yourself. That's part of the learning process. So my first piece of advice is don't be afraid to make mistakes. I made many mistakes in my first couple of years, and I still do. There's so much to learn and practice with this hobby that you can't expect to be perfect at it. You just have to roll with being imperfect and having the patience to just try again and again. And if you do that, you'll be amazed when you look back at just how much you've learned and how much better your images get over the years. So something I like to do is return to some of my favorite deep sky objects every few years and reshoot them. And I think this is a really nice exercise to see how your skill has progressed, but also to see how your style has evolved. This is the kind of comparison that I like. I try not to compare myself too much to others and their images, but it can be fun to compare your current self to your past self. And if you're in the hobby long enough, you'll see both improvement in your own abilities, of course, but also improvement in the gear and especially in the processing software and techniques that we all get to use to get better and better pictures. So my second piece of advice is occasionally reshoot your favorite deep sky objects and compare them to past times you shot them, and then you'll see how you've progressed. And my third piece of advice is, I think, more helpful after you've been in the hobby a couple years maybe. You might start feeling like you're in a bit of a rut at times, or feeling burnt out is another way to put it. And you can always take a break, of course, but for me, what I found the best antidote is to just try something completely new. Challenge yourself. And it can be a silly challenge. It doesn't have to be something serious. So try just taking a bunch of 1 second pictures of a bright nebula and stack them and see what you can get out of that. Or limit yourself to just 1 hour total integration. And these kinds of challenges will make you a better astrophotographer because they will reveal the limitations of your understanding and thinking and make you seek out new ways of trying things and doing things. And if you'd like a new challenge every month, suggested by me, you can join my Patreon, where I do organize a monthly imaging challenge on our Patreon side of the Discord. Another thing I've learned in my 10 years doing this is that there's lots of different approaches to astrophotography. Some people will like the very technical aspects of it and really fine-tuning their gear or even making their own mounts and telescopes and things. And some people just like getting under the stars and want the gear to just work. They don't really like the tuning of it. And so for them, it's more about either the experience or the final picture. And so there are many different ways to enjoy it. It's a hobby. And my point is, let people enjoy it however they want. Like, sometimes I see people put down different approaches, whatever it is, like, you know, remote imaging or smart telescopes, you name it. And I just think, why? Just because someone else wants to do the hobby a different way than you doesn't stop you from photographing space the way you want to do it. So I guess my fourth piece of advice is don't needlessly criticize how someone else wants to enjoy astrophotography. It's perfectly fine that there are many different approaches or philosophies. And, you know, in other words, I don't think that there's one correct way to be an astrophotographer. And I also think it's very possible to express the way you feel about astrophotography without putting down or disparaging the way others approach it. Okay, that said, that sounds a little negative, but for the most part, I think the astrophotography community is actually a very positive place. And I'd encourage everyone watching this to engage with other astrophotographers. I think that we all have something to add to, you know, the larger community, and there are many different ways to get involved. There's the online communities, whether it's Discord or social media or Patreon. There are in-person star parties, outreach events, and of course, there are the in-person astronomy clubs. Even if you're sort of introverted, like I'm actually pretty introverted, I'd encourage you to at least check out your local astronomy club if you have one. You know, I got an amazing amount of help from the Delaware Astronomical Society when I was just getting started. And I found that the yearly dues at every club that I've been a part of in the US are very reasonable, like in the range of $35 to $70 per year. And astronomy clubs often have a lot of cool perks, like the use of observatories, dark sky locations, loaner gear, all kinds of cool stuff. So the fifth piece of advice is interact with other astrophotographers, however, you know, makes sense for you. And my sixth piece of advice is to try printing out your photos sometime. I think that adds a whole other dimension to the hobby, and I'm always surprised to find out how few of us print out our work. I have a whole video on this topic, so I won't belabor this point, but there's something really different about a tangible physical print of your astrophoto compared to just seeing it on the screen, especially if you have enough resolution to print it out big. You don't have to buy a home photo printer to try this out. The one I'm holding here was done on aluminum by a commercial lab called Bay Photo. But I'll say that home printing also has some advantages in your ability to fine tune your print and that, you know, the whole process of trying to get the best print is a good cloudy night activity. You can really sort of refine it with like lots of little test prints. Okay, and my seventh and I think final piece of advice after 10 years of doing this is dark skies are totally worth it. I know that many of you watching don't have much choice in where you live, and your access to dark skies can of course be limited based on where you live. But if you're watching this and you do have some means, like a car, to get out there and get somewhere darker, it really will make a difference to the quality of your photo. And the biggest reason I actually quit my job in the Boston area to go full-time with Nebula Photos is so I could move here to rural New Hampshire and live under dark skies permanently. That's what I really like about living here the most, and I never get over it or take it for granted. Every time I get a clear night here and I see that Milky Way band overhead, I am just so grateful to be here. And this is my piece of advice, I think, that really is that it doesn't, you don't have to get to the darkest skies on Earth or anything. When I was getting started, I was in a Bortle 8, and I could literally drive just 15 minutes to a friend's house, and it was like Bortle 6. And you may not think that makes a huge difference, but it does. People don't consider Bortle 6 a dark sky, but coming from Bortle 8, it makes a huge difference. So really, if there's anything you could do to get a little advantage with sky darkness, it really is worth the effort. So 10 years in, I can say I still love photographing deep space just as much as that first night. And I hope everyone watching this shares my love of the hobby and will continue to enjoy it for many years to come. Short of printing, another great way to display your accomplishments is your own website on your own domain. Like I have mine at nicocarver.com. And this website was made with this video sponsor, Squarespace. And when you set up your site with Squarespace, you'll have many different easy-to-use options for design. Mine is a fairly simple, but I think elegant portfolio site for my astrophotography. And if I ever want to change the design, Squarespace has an excellent design system called Squarespace Blueprint that makes that really easy to do. I also like that so much is built in, including a spam-free contact form and tons of selling tools. I haven't turned this on myself, but it's nice to know that if I ever wanted an online store to sell prints or services through my website, that is really easy to turn on and set up, and customers can pay however is most convenient to them, whether it's PayPal, credit card, or Afterpay. So if you need a website and you want to try this out, head over to squarespace.com/nebulaphotos for a free trial. And when ready to make a first-time purchase of hosting or a domain, use code NebulaPhotos at checkout for 10% off. Well, that's it. Thanks so much for joining me again, and wishing everyone clear skies and happy holidays.